saying to myself, with my brother's 45. Thank you. 13 kids, and my grandparents were from Syria and Lebanon, and they settled in East Los Angeles. And so my dad grew up in the barrio, Whittier Boulevard. And he had this amazing life. And he was a scientist. He set the global catch quotas for tuna. Which is a big deal to a bunch of countries. Like at one point for Mexico, that was the third largest part of their GDP. I think the same for Japan. I was just in Japan and went to lunch with his counterpart in Tokyo. You know, guys like have godhood status in Japan because it's all about fucking tuna. So my dad had this. It started this initiative. It was the first time that the conservation industry, conservation and the fishing industry had worked together on a global conservation program. There was a young, pretty amazing CEO of Starkist Tuna. Actually, me and that guy did the eulogy at my dad's funeral, but it was, he was with my mom and they were in Africa and that's where they were starting in the Seychelles and Mauritius and stuff. My dad got sick, and then they went to Syria because he'd been to Lebanon and found my grandmother's village, and then I recently went and found my grandmother with Michele. She found my grandmother's village. But they had gone to Damascus because it had opened up for a minute, and at that point my dad was so sick that the Four Seasons was like, you gotta go home. Had he not gone home, he probably would have lived, but because he ended up, he died of it. But here's a guy, the most traveled human that I know in the world, but he was from Los Angeles, plane lands in LA, and people welcome to Los Angeles. Stands up to grab his bag, he drops dead. But he was sitting next to his wife for 50 years, he was at the top of his fucking game, and he was home. And so I think it was extraordinarily beautiful, you know, for him. So I wrote this song. This is called LAX. And it's so weird the other day because it was his birthday, but I missed the flight in New Orleans, so they rerouted me. And I didn't pay attention to it. And I got off the plane and went, fuck, I'm at LAX. Excuse me. Satellite signal says you're taking an earlier flight. Damascus to Heathrow via the city of light. To the city of angels. Huh. Ran down to kiss you goodbye, but they're closing the gates. Like warfare and drugs and young lovers, no one wants to wait. City of angels, angels, here in LAX. Packages, parcels, and burdens you're leaving behind. You can't take it with you, so why in the world should they mind? Departure, not wishing for anything different. This is all that there is. I'll wear a shirt that is his. Departures. Departures. Here at LAX. Satellite. Thank you. cross that she bears. Departures like the last days of Indian summer, when I sneaks through the cracks, feeling a chill, but there isn't a dog to get by. This is for a different gym. My dad in the gym, and then I had my spiritual mentor. He's dead, so it's not breaking his name or anything, but he was also my AA sponsor. And this guy Jim, and he was a doctoral Tibetan Buddhist. He was one of three translators for the Dalai Lama. I think he was the only white American of those three. And he was a heavy guy because in AA, the first step is to admit that you're powerless. And the Buddha teaches you that you have the power. And so it's a crazy walk to watch him walk. And I was in Ireland, and he, I tell the story softly, but he was headed to his teacher's death. And this guy was one of the high lamas. I think they only recognize like 24 of the reincarnates. There's not that many people that think. This guy was one of them. And what Jim did is he would listen to these guys as they, through meditation, went into their past lives, and then he would transcribe the ancient dead languages and listening to these guys, you know, he always gave a pretty good argument about reincarnation. But the I had been to the funeral of the High Lama. I was in Nepal, and there's this guy, Henry Todd. Henry, there's a movie about him. It was the biggest ecstasy bust in British history. He goes to Nepal to hide, and then he figures out how to get the Sherpas to bring the empty oxygen tanks off of Everest. You want to climb Everest, you got to buy your fucking oxygen from Henry Todd. And he hates Americans. Fucking hates them. So I meet him, and after a while he goes, "Can you keep your Yankee fucking mouth shut?" And I'm like, "Okay, I'm going to show you something that no one's ever seen." And we go through all the stuff, and it's not a funeral, but one of the High Lamas had just died. Henry had smuggled his body from Tibet into Nepal so that they could have this ceremony. And basically what they do is these guys die, and there's a couple of days of reverence, and then there's a bunch of days of, like, making them leave. Like, you gotta fucking go, man. You're dead. Time to die. And it's a kind of a big thing, because otherwise they'll hang around, you know? And so they want them to move on. And so I'd seen this. And then Jim starts sending me these pictures, and day one of his teacher dying, he quits breathing. Day eight, the monks declare that his consciousness has left, and the doctors say that rigor mortis is sick. Believe it. Don't fucking believe it. But the photos were interesting, and I've not really had anybody send me pictures of 8-day death. Unfortunately, at the same time, I didn't know that Jim was sick. And I got this call from his wife. They wouldn't have called me because he made a great casserole. So I went for a run in the Irish countryside. I wrote this song under the idea that he was dying. And then I came back and he had indeed died. So, you know, when your friends die, you're supposed to write a song. Ireland is a really great place to do that. Because that's all they fucking write about, right? When he died or she leaves. Or she leaves and he died. Very unlike you. That was a very long story, I'm sorry. This is called Craters We Know.
Ancestors all dance, they're champing it down with
Supposed to be giving the song to Jerry Garcia. And so I wrote these songs thinking of